late Jessica Mathews, president of the Carnegie Endowment. It's a great pleasure to welcome all of you here today and this very distinguished panel. Carnegie is a international network of research centers that are located in Moscow, Beijing, Beirut, Brussels, and Washington, and next year in New Delhi. They are each of them locally staffed and locally led, and they work on issues that are both unique to that country or region, and together on issues that are of global significance and relevance, whether it's environment, trade, security, geopolitics, the whole gamut. And today's subject is one that fits both the local and regional criterion of importance and one that is, I think, of global importance. Because its subject, a new ambition for Europe, a memo to the new EU foreign policy chief and really foreign policy team, is one that is of huge importance to Europe, therefore of great importance to the United States, and of global significance as well. It is written, the report that you have received and for which this is the formal launch event, by a group of Carnegie scholars, Jan Techau, who is the director of Europe, Stefan Lehne, Ulrich Specht, all of whom are here today, and Dan Cohane from Frida, who is also here. The publication is intentionally short, which means that the process of arriving at it was very long. It came out of a series of six expert seminars and many long writing sessions over the course of this past year to try to arrive at a consensus on the key issues and then boil them down to their essence. The result is it's a demanding document to read because there is an idea in virtually every sentence. It is, I think, coming out at an enormously timely moment. The new team, of course, is still looking for desks and telephones and business cards, but the effect of this document, which has been circulated some, is already very evident. And its message, the vision that the authors were attempting to achieve and to convey, is that a new EU leadership team needs to pursue a new strategy to make Europe a more effective global actor, a strategic actor. And the impact of this message, which I hope will be the core of today's discussion, has already gained substantial traction both here in Brussels and around Europe in the member states. The memo makes the case, the core of the argument, that the EU needs to become far more secure in its foreign policy purpose and ambitions, and that doing so is a matter of existential importance to the Union and to the region. It's a matter of securing Europe's welfare and prosperity in response to the challenges that now surround it, inside but more importantly also outside the Union. The EU, we know, is in its deepest essence a rules-based system designed to resolve conflict and enable the nations of Europe to live together in peace and prosperity. And for a long time, the European project has been focused on this ambitious and important original ambition. But we dare not live mentally in a time that no longer exists. And today, peace in Europe does not only depend on the EU's inner workings, It will depend in equal or, I would guess, greater measure on Europeans' ability to bring about peace and stability outside its borders. Foreign policy, in other words, can no longer be a sideshow in EU affairs. It must be at its very heart and center. This is the core of the belief that the author shared from the outset and attempted to turn into policy recommendations that they have laid before you today. This has been the focus of Carnegie Europe's work for about 4 years, Europe's role as a strategic actor. And it will not be the end of that process, but rather the beginning of a broader one, we hope. We see this document, today's discussion, as beginning a conversation around what is laid out here. We hope that conversation will deepen and broaden and improve the thoughts that the authors have laid out, and that perhaps a new version, a new and improved version, based on conversations all around Europe, will come out of that process. Today's world order is, I think we all would agree, brittle and shaky, and the European pillar of it needs to be much stronger than it has been to date. We have a superb panel, cast of panelists here to discuss the memo, to take it apart, to add to it, and we are very grateful to each of them for joining us today. I think it would be hard to gather a more qualified group of panelists who have both the knowledge of how governments work from inside and the distance and instinct of scholarship that comes and freedom of thought that comes from working outside. That's the balance that we look for and have, I think, found today. So we are in the hands of Judy Dempsey as our moderator, who edits Carnegie's Strategic Europe blog and has been writing steadily on this subject for years and years. I think all of you know her writing. We also have Marta Dassù, who is the Senior Director of European Affairs at Aspen, Italy in Rome, and who previously served as Italy's Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs. Justin Vaïsse, next to Jan Techau here, is the Director of Policy Planning Staff at the French Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Robin Niblett is the Director of Chatham House, next to Marta. And at my left here, Jan Techau, one of the authors of the program and the Director of Carnegie Europe. So, Judy, we're now in your hands and the audience's hands for a great discussion. Thank you so much, and thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much, Jessica. Thank you very much for coming over. It means a lot to us. And thank you very much for your thoughtful, very trenchant and important comments on perhaps what Europe should be. And we won't dwell on the past on that. And and of course, thank you very much for the audience. Thank you for making the time. I mean, there's so much competition for all of you to attend so many venues and meetings and other events in Brussels. Thank you very much. Now, this format is very straightforward. I know our speakers, our distinguished speakers, because they work very, very hard, they don't have to give any opening statements or any speeches. And the whole idea is that I shall ask each of them, and they can all interrupt, of course, one question each, of course, based on the report, and Jan will pick up any weaknesses or strengths of the report as well. And we will have a thorough discussion on this for at least 45 minutes or an hour. And we really want to trash an awful lot of issues out of this report, which is mercifully short, really. But as Jessica said, it took a long time in the making. So I'm going to kick off with questions to all of you, all very different questions. And I just want to tell you, I'm not going to, they haven't been really primed. I told them the questions, but they're not going to get the questions that I asked them. So, this is a very nasty trick. Anyway, so I think it's only fair that I start with Jan. He's nursed, shepherded this report through for many, many, many intense months. And so he doesn't know what I'm going to ask him. So, Jan, this is your chance. when you actually look at this paper, do you really think that the institutions are up to it or are prepared to take on board any of the recommendations and implement them? And okay, by the way, the whole idea is to have a dialogue on this and have the questions relatively punchy and answer short.
I think that is actually really a question that I didn't expect. But it's an important, and perhaps even in the context of Brussels, the crucial question. I think the institutions are perfectly capable of doing this. The question is twofold. Are they willing to do it? And will the member states let them do it? Because we should not forget, in all of our obsession about institutions in this town, that the member states are running the show in foreign policy. And the institutions can shepherd, can inform, can guide, can suggest, but they cannot really run it. There are, of course, parts of foreign policy in trade and perhaps in development here and there where the institutions have a high degree of autonomy or even full autonomy. But in the classic field of foreign policy, that's not the case. That's where the member states are jealously guarding their prerogatives. And so the big question, I guess, is, also that we tried to tackle in the paper is, how can the institutions position themselves to not be sidelined by the member states too much, to be the real guardians of the European-wide interest, and to make EU foreign policy more the sum of its member states' parts? And this is why we put institutional as much as well to a large degree on whether the institutions can suggest stuff to the member states that has become so compelling and so intelligent and so constructive for them that it's very hard for them to sideline it. Mm. And then it depends on the member states, whether they're willing to actually pool it a bit more here in this town. And we've seen in recent months, a tendency to not do that. Yeah. And so, I'm optimistic in theory, but, practice seems to indicate that it's going to be a very tough call.
Well, you see, in your paper, and I see Uli Speck is here, one of the authors, and Daniel Fleet and Stefan, the whole team is actually here, which is great. The thing is, in your paper, you mentioned this idea of a national security council or the head of a national security agency type. Marta, do you think this is a good idea?
It's a good idea in the sense that you give a title to a concept. If that means that Federica Mogherini has not to conceive herself as the number 29 foreign minister, this is okay. And yet, in my view, there are many differences. And so I don't think that this analogy is the perfect one, letting aside the fact that national is a bit strange to be applied to the role of Federica. Two points are important in my view. The first one is how much foreign policy will be recognized as a real priority. This is linking to you, Jan. And from this point of view, the paper is very important indeed, because you rightly say this is existential. And in my view, it is existential, not only because challenges are important, but also for political reasons. And let me quote two points. The first one is that part of the Eurosceptical anti-European parties are pro-Putin, for instance. And the second point is the importance of migration, for instance, in a team that it is exploited again by anti-European forces. So my point is, either we are able to manage foreign policy in an effective way, or the European Union itself will be at risk. So, starting from that, Federica's role will be very important, and we can discuss it later. My viewpoint is that she will be effective if she will be able to do much more than Katy, I have to say, a coordination effort. She has to be able to give a foreign policy ambition to all these different strands of the external action.
Marta, It's really interesting that you bring up the immigration issue, because we have Robin here, who's based in London, as everybody knows, and the Prime Minister of Great Britain still is David Cameron, and immigration is very much a very serious issue. What would Cameron think of this paper?
We're probably glad that migration doesn't feature in it very much, actually, because I would think at the moment he's trying to strike up some bilateral deals on that, and then he'd rather people talked about it more broadly at an EU level, I think, once he's got his position sorted out with Germany. So what would he like or not like? I mean, the Brits are most worried about process, because they're most worried about sovereignty. I'm generalizing, okay? But certainly you said, let's take it as a David Cameron Conservative Party viewpoint in particular. So when anything about overambition will worry the Brits, because they'll have to react against it, because overambition will sound like it needs a process to make it manageable. So if a paper starts out saying the EU should become, actually I wrote this down, a powerhouse of global order, yeah. Well, that'll probably turn some of the Brits off, because they just can't see the EU as a powerhouse in global order. And I think that kind of, the high ambition, and it's maybe British more generally, the hyperbole would get an antibody or two into the bloodstream. But I think the process, actually, some of the lines may be a little worrying. I picked out the line that there's something about the High Representative giving tasks to the foreign ministers. I think, you know, the way that David Cameron would see be the opposite, yes? That the task will be given by the foreign ministers to the High Representative. The idea that public communications will create influence or give the EU the capacity to have influence, again, probably not a British viewpoint, where it would be more about results. If there's results, then you have influence. And I think actually the results that Cathy Ashton was able to achieve towards the tail end of her time actually have changed some British views, probably as to where the EAS could be useful. I mean, I think it's interesting on the National Security Council bit. I think I share maybe some of Marta's standpoint. The word national is a little strange, but it could be changed. But more importantly, the reason you have the word National Security Council is they sit at the center of power. They sit at the center of power. Yet, as Jan said himself, the center of power in foreign policy is the national capitals. So you have a National Security Council in Brussels. In a way, it's a bit of a contradiction in terms. However, I think, to be very fair to the paper, and this is where the Brits probably would be soft on it, is that most of the recommendations on process are more about strategic analysis and coordination than about proactivity. I think there'd be actually quite, having said all these points, there's a lot to like, I think, from a broadly British perspective. It's global in its ambition. It talks a lot about China and about the neighborhood. It talks a lot about the importance of our defense. It's pretty tough on Russia, which would be a standpoint, I think, that would be shared in most circles, though not all in Britain. That's not, you know, there are debates in Britain as well as to how tough to be there as well. This focus on other partners, Brazil, Indonesia, South Africa, Japan, the government's been trying to do that, you know, and how to build up relations with China. So I think, and cybersecurity, huge issue for the UK government, where I think they appreciate, like energy security, they're going to have to team up with others. So I think actually on the process, a few little nervous looks, but on the grand strategy, probably quite supportive.
And that's really a plus aspect of the paper, that its breadth is very wide. It gets out of the European box. But you mentioned this process, and we discussed this briefly before we met. I mean, a process is both... It's such an old term. It's nearly run its course, perhaps, maybe for some of the institutions, maybe not for the Commission. But Justin, let me bring you in here when we talk about process and foreign policy. I mean, in the European context, when you listen to Robin and Martin Jan, I mean, what does foreign policy mean?
You know, I guess in the small sense of the term, or in the restricted sense of the term, it's about managing external relations, right? It's about the good ones, the positive ones, the good exchanges we have with the outside, the near abroad or the further abroad, and the more negative ones that we want to guard against. But in the larger sense, it's about projecting oneself. It's about projecting one's preferences on the on one's environment, and so that means a lot of different things. And so, in this sense, I do believe that the paper is sharp and offers many views. I think it also lacks a few of both of the instruments to talk about how we affect our environment, And also another issue about the European narrative that I will go into. But let me first say a few words. I think there are many things, many good things. The National Security Advisor metaphor is good. I disagree with it, but it helps think things through. I think the High Representative plays on many different chessboards, even more than the National Security Advisor, who has to manage very raucous bureaucracies and you know, public opinion in different countries. But for the High Representative, it's her own bureaucracy, it's the member states, it's also the relationship with the Commission, it's European public opinions, and of course it's the international scene. And so it's even more complex than I think the National Security Advisor metaphor lets it think about. But leaving that aside, I think among the tools to affect the environment, you know, we could talk about, and one great thing about the paper is that it's just 5 pages long. I mean, that it's been restricted, and thank God it's not 55 pages, because that would have been a temptation that would have led to a paper that few people would have read. I would have read it, but I mean, a few other people would have read it. Here it's short, but you know, we could have talked about culture, and also about sanctions. Yeah. I think sanctions is a tool of growing importance for Europe. We've been using sanctions not just as a default tool, even if sometimes that can seem the case, but also as a tool of choice in order to have leverage on other places. And there are many different countries in the world which are under European sanctions. And I think these sanctions are actually effective, not as a crisis management tool, but precisely to create that rapport de force, as we say in French, that exists. So that's just one, you know, one small thing that I think would need to fit in the global view of what foreign policy is. And perhaps a last one, if I can have just one more minute, is about, you know, I like the global ambition and the idea of, you know, just the first thing, expanding global order. I think we've enormously benefited from the norms and from the order that was created after World War II, largely thanks to the US, but also thanks to what EU founders have done. And I think the EU has been a contributor to that world order and to that process and to these norms. However, we should also be conscious of the fact that, you know, power relations are changing, and the world is changing. And for being lucky enough to travel quite a bit, I must say that beyond Europe and beyond the U.S., in New Delhi, in Indonesia, in Russia, obviously, in Brazil, and elsewhere, our narrative, the European narrative, is not winning. Not only because we've been weakened by the financial and economic crisis, but also because our narrative on the Ukrainian crisis, on the Middle East, is generally not dominant. Only 100 countries have voted in favor of just reaffirming what was in the UN Charter at the UN General Assembly when it was about voting on Russia. So my point, and to put it in a nutshell, is that if foreign policy is about affecting one's environment, we should also think of this aspect of you know, does the world buy our narrative and the way we present things? So are we managing in transforming the world to our own image?
It's a very important point. Jan, why aren't we winning the narrative? Because which Justin brings up.
It's an inconvenient narrative. It's a narrative that, you know, doesn't let you off the hook easily. It's very easy to say, you know, why should we worry about Ukraine? Why should we worry about these tedious questions of sovereignty? And if you follow through with the narrative, that means also that you need to back it up, which is enormously expensive, requires political engagement at the highest level and for a long, long time, plus, you know, with a guarantee that comes with it that you will be in conflict with the Russians, you know, by definition. So it's a very, very inconvenient, you know, narrative. It's much easier to kind of, you know, turn around and turn your back on it. And not, you know, start looking at that kind of runs. And only a few number of countries, if we are really honest with ourselves, are tangibly touched by it yet. You know, the narrative about, you know, the European security order at risk is not something that everybody feels. And so it becomes, you know, a huge kind of mountain that you have to argue against when you want to make that case.
But Robin, do you want to pick up on this? Our narrative has been challenged with the Russia crisis. I mean, China challenges it in different ways without any kind of conditionality or conditions when they're investing Africa, for instance, or Latin America. Yes.
That's why I think I'd have some sympathy about the critique, let's say, of the global powerhouse. Just the fact is that the EU right now is in a difficult period. I mean, the paper rightly says foreign policy starts at home. But EU countries right now are demonstrating the fragility of democracy rather than the resilience of democracy. And if that is a starting point, as other countries look in and are wondering to what extent would we follow or be partners with European countries, who're saying, well, you're struggling with growth, you know, you're structurally challenged in terms of demography, and ultimately your political systems, all of you, from the UK to Nordics to Southern, this isn't some particular part of Europe, you're all at risk. So how are you guys going to deliver growth when you've overreached in the past? And I think we're all still paying a price in these not following us in the UN votes on Russia and Ukraine. We're paying the price of the sense that Western powers overreached in their foreign policy when they should have been focused on their citizens. And we, other governments, are focused on our citizens. And if you overreach on foreign policy, you can't deliver what you need in terms of growth. So let's not follow yet again, you know, Europe and America into protecting their notions of international order, which seem to be run rather, you know, selectively. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's very hard to push the narrative at that time. I think if there was one line, maybe the line actually I didn't like in the paper, just on this point, because I think it plays into this feeling. It's this line I think it talked about, we must prod China and Russia to become global stakeholders, responsible global stakeholders.
Yeah, right.
You know, to me, that's what they don't like. I mean, who's stakeholder, you know, whose rules? You guys don't always follow the rules, you know. And also, you're lumping China and Russia together, and I think they are on very, very different tracks. But let me stop there.
Marta, you wanted to come in there?
No, I totally agree with this point. I mean, the narrative implied that the European Union was a working organization, after all. So the impact of the financial crisis, of the current stagnation on foreign policy is a huge one, precisely because we had this foreign policy of example. And from this point of view, the paper is very good because it is an invitation to change this and to be able to project a foreign policy which is not only based upon the European model, because this is a non-starter. One point I would like to raise, if I can, of the paper. There are many, many, many points I am in agreement with. For instance, they need to become a bit more realist. See Russia as it is. It is one of the sentences in the paper on which I agree. There are other points which are much more general, the one Robin just mentioned, but also, for instance, this kind of idea that enlargement can go on, notwithstanding the fact, and this is a point you rightly underline, that enlargement has no enough public support now. So this is an important point in my view. How much can we go on promising things that do not happen? We pay a cost for that. For instance, we are losing Turkey also for that. And so from my point of view, from a methodological point of view, the idea to go on promising formulas that are not going in the end to become true, to be implemented, is a very serious mistake.
The Turkey example is very important because it's not just Turkey's problem and Turkey's fault, if you want to call it this. I mean, the EU, the Commission and the Council made any number of mistakes in dealing with Turkey and allowing Cyprus to actually block some of the chapters. You have to call a spade on this. And this has actually alienated Turkey and it's done very little for the kind of democracy and the civil society in Turkey. This is a huge mistake that Brussels will sooner rather than later regret. Yeah. But I want to bring up this enlargement issue because we can't escape from it. We have the issue with Ukraine. We haven't put enlargement on the table. We have the Western Balkans. We have the aspirations of Turkey. I mean, Turkey is still not monolithic, thankfully. I mean, Belarus, we have so much unfinished business in our own neighborhood before we even talk about Latin America and China. Jan, is the European experiment, is post-war Europe contingent on enlargement?
No, I don't think so. I don't think that enlargement is a very key building block after the end of the Cold War, obviously, but it is not the essence alone of what makes the EU. And so I would say no to that. That doesn't mean I easily dismiss it. I think it has proven to be the most, you know, geostrategically effective tool in the European toolbox, you know, over the last, you know, 25 years or so. And that's also the reason why the Europeans find it so difficult to abandon it. It has worked really miracles for them. I mean, look at the record on the eastern flank of the EU, what it has done there. And so it's very difficult to say no to the tool that has worked so well for you. But we are now at the point where we face this dilemma where enlargement, of course, becomes both more difficult to absorb at home, mm-hmm. but we also find less and less candidates who are actually intrinsically motivated themselves to go to great lengths to actually join, to do the painful reforms. Part of the dilemma of the neighborhood policy was, of course, to implement parts of that enlargement process, use the same tools, and transform these places. And we've seen that has not been very effective. And even the member states, you know, the accession candidates are not, you know, splendid on their record. So finding candidates that are willing, intrinsically motivated and willing to do the reforms becomes more difficult. Having said all this, I would say, you know, we should be cautious. We should not overpromise, but we should also not say this is over forever, because there might come a moment, you know, at some point down the road where we will have to reactivate that tool, and then we will be, you know, very happy that we still have people who remember how to do it.
Indeed. Justin, yes.
Just evoked something about, of course, Russia, because we have tended to consider that precisely, you know, bathed in this narrative that we were a force for good, that there was a form of soft imperialism, etc., that enlargement was an unmitigated good that everyone was supposed to see as such. Well, Vladimir Putin, for one, started, I think, considering it with, you know, benign neglect, if not outright contempt, to be honest. Mm-hmm. I think he didn't have much regard and doesn't have much regard for Brussels, for the Eurocrats who give gay marriage to everyone and who are decadent in their mores and manners. But last year, which precisely sort of demonstrated that enlargement is not just a technical issue, and it's not just about these countries. It's also a political project of deep political significance, and so we have to conceive it as such. And when the first idea of the Eastern Partnership was out, it was, what do we do with these countries that are not supposed to have accession, at least not for a very, very long time, and how do we deal with them? And it, you know, it more or less became an antechamber for accession. And I think it's not good. It's not good for these countries. It's not good for our relations with Russia. Russia sees EU accession as a threat for some of the countries that surround it. We should not give it a veto. But on the other hand, if it's not our aim to have them join in the short or medium term, why make it an issue? Plus, Russia, of course, sees that not only as an antechamber for EU accession, but also as an antechamber for NATO accession. You know, after having seen in the 1990s and in 2000s that all countries that were joining the EU were joining NATO. So here I think there's a fundamental point in the overall relation with Russia issue where we have to find the right balance between, on the one hand, not giving a veto to Russia on our policies, but on the other hand, realizing that that what we do abroad are deeply political.
Yes, please.
I want to come in. I think this is a... This goes to the heart of the paper as well. I think this issue of how Russia sees us, how we see Russia. To me, one of the most important lines in the paper is the one about giving priorities to strengthening national and institutional governance. And we have to start with that at home. I know it's applied through the paper, actually, not just in Europe. And it's applied to Middle East, it's applied globally, and I subscribe to it globally. But with place we absolutely have to start is at home. Personally, my view is I'm not as worried about how Russia sees us. I don't think we should indulge in President Putin's world views, which ultimately, if you see where they rooted, where they came from, yes, we probably contributed to it and fed the narrative here and there with some bad mistakes, but ultimately I think it was inevitable. We need to think about how we see Russia, and in particular how we see Russia in the context of the importance of institutional governance and strong states. within Europe, and importantly for the EU, within our neighbours. Mm. If our neighbours are brought into a sphere, not of influence, but also of economic, opaque, corrupt activity, and that corruption, we are so arrogant as to think, mm-hmm. will not penetrate into London, mm. Berlin, Paris, mm. Rome, etc., then I think we're into a dangerous future. Never mind being a global powerhouse, we won't be a European powerhouse. I think we need to be really very firm, in my opinion, on this view of where we draw the line in the place that is most unique to Europe, which is the rule of law mm-hmm. and transparency. At least we aspire to that. Let me just say, therefore, the bit that frustrates me about the paper, mm-hmm. I'm not seeing there, is Ukraine. I mean, you know, Ukraine comes up very little in the paper as Ukraine, maybe once, twice. This is the battleground. Now, whether you give it an enlargement perspective in the long term or not, personally, I just don't think that for Western Europe and Central Europe and the EU's future, mm. one can sort of be halfway about Ukraine. I think you've got to commit.
Yeah, I would like, can I just ask Jan about this? You're actually hitting on values, really, the whole issue of values, and in fact our double standards, where we have some of our own member states.
But the values is a part of security.
Absolutely.
Of not just because they're nice.
But I mean, we cannot, you see, we can't talk about Russia without talking about Ukraine. We can't talk about Ukraine without talking about Russia, but we shouldn't see Ukraine through the prism of Russia, which we have seen how we have viewed Eastern Europe for such a long time. Jan, do you think, why isn't Ukraine part of a bigger discussion of the paper?
Before I answer that, let me just ask Robin real quick, because you said we can't be halfway about Ukraine, and you apply this to enlargement as well?
I think the perspective of, as you said in the paper, treating European neighbours different from neighbours of Europe mm-hmm. applies to Ukraine. So the association agreement strikes me as a good starting point. In the long, long term, to use your phraseology back to yourself, I think the idea of not taking away a perspective that later on you might need mm-hmm. certainly applies to Ukraine. Mm-hmm. So I think, I mean, my personal view, it's a long, long, long way away, but I wouldn't take away an ultimate enlargement perspective to Ukraine.
On your question, Judy, we had long debates about, you know, whether we should make this, you know, a central point of it, because we all, in our group of four, we understand and we agreed that this was the big litmus test for EU foreign policy. Yeah. If this doesn't work, I mean, it's the first time that we're out there without the assistance of the big boys over the Atlantic, you know, that we have the tools for it and that our own security is so, you know, kind of immediately affected, and now we have to get it done. And if this doesn't work, then, you know, what will? But at the same time, we decided not to make it a Ukraine paper.
Yes, of course.
Because you can easily start to obsess about a single case and then it ages very quickly. And also, we wanted to kind of distill a few more fundamental rules out of this. And Ukraine is just one case in the neighborhood. Mm. It is perhaps the biggest and the crown jewel, if you will, in the neighborhood, you know, conundrum. But, you know, had we focused on this too much, I think it would have been too much in the news
yes.
cycle. And
a paragraph on Eastern Europe and Russia, just one yeah. mention of it would be...
Yeah.
I think, Robin, you said it was great that it was just five pages.
No, I didn't.
We could have easily...
He didn't. I went on to page 12, 13, and I liked the fact it was 12, 13.
I don't know why everybody says it's five pages. I counted 13 this morning.
Exactly. Yeah, and Ukraine's not on the 13.
Wait a second. You see, Jan, I mean, you have written this. I mean, this is a new... This is something so new for Europe, but so fundamental. Because for the Ukraine crisis... shows that this is about a competition. It's a serious competition which we cannot afford to lose. And how Japan will see us, I mean, how China will see us over Ukraine, how Latin America, I mean, we saw what was happening in Brisbane, apart from Chancellor Merkel's talk with Putin, but there was Putin, he had no friends except the BRICS so far. They're still friends with him. But this is a serious competition that is just not about Ukraine or Russia. It's about our integrity of having a serious foreign policy that is based on values and competition. And I don't know if the institutions and the member states are aware of this. Marta.
One word on yes. that. It could have been interesting, in my view, Jan, to try to understand in the paper why we made some mistakes, let's put it this way, in Ukraine, because clearly we mismanaged that. and the lessons learned are important. So this is a missing link in my view. One word I would like to add on that is that apparently, as far as I know, the first Foreign Affairs Council run by Federica Mogherini precisely was on Ukraine, and she introduced a new methodology which could be a very good innovation in a sense. She produced an issue paper on Ukraine with many different options. This goes in the direction of the National Security Advisor, if you wish. And that was the discussion on Ukraine, leaving aside Russia for a moment, for the next council, but apparently it went on very, very well. So, judging from this first council, the idea, some of the ideas you raise in the paper are already at work.
Good to hear.
That's well, actually, I want to pick up both of you on this. Actually, I don't agree with you, Marta. I think it would have been a mistake, because it would have been unending, to write about the lessons learned. I mean, what the paper...
Mistake?
I think it would have been a mistake to say, what lessons have we learned? Because there are so many topics we could have brought up, apart from Libya, of course, and Ukraine. I think they were right to focus on the future. This is very important. What I find interesting about an aspect of the paper, which, in fact, maybe gives too great a role to the foreign ministries, and maybe Mogherini's role may be easier, because foreign policy now is really in the hands of chancelleries in the Prime Minister's office, really. So we see the foreign policy shift on the national level, that's become very much in the Chancellery. I'd be interested in what you say. And
no,
oh no, of course, I've forgotten.
Yes, join the wrong part of the government.
Foreign Ministry, yes, yes. Yes. But I mean, it is an interesting, we have seen this evolve over the past couple of years. Jan, do you have any thoughts on this? I mean, will it make the institutions more brittle, or actually this is not a bad thing that the leaders make the foreign policy?
I mean, this is really Stefan Lehne's topic, who is asking in a forthcoming Carnegie paper whether prime ministers can actually do foreign policy. And you know, wait for a brilliant piece of reading, and it's going to be out soon. No, I mean, it is on the one hand, it is a sign that at the EU level, member states realize, you know, how important this is, and that this indeed can't be a sideshow any longer. That's the good side of it. On the other hand is, when you go to the top level for foreign policy, you know, right away, you know, kind of keep the foreign ministers out of the equation, you lose escalation depth. You go to the big boys right away, and then, you know, once something ends there, it ends there. And you don't have the preparatory phases that you need, where you need to straighten things out and have reflection time built into it. And then, plus, the other thing is that, of course, there's a fantastic tendency in all member states, I think, of chancelleries and president's offices and prime minister's office to sideline the foreign ministries, have it all done by their, you know, short, kind of small group of advisors, you know, thereby losing out on perspective and on depth and of knowledge. And it's an, you know, and that tendency, of course, is worrisome. And I think perhaps in an ideal little world, you know, Ms. Mogherini in her new job can perhaps work a little bit as an antidote to this by activating the foreign ministers more, if that's in her capacity. Mm. She needs a lot of skill for that, though.
Justin.
I think, you know, where you stand depends on where you sit, right?
Yes.
We all know that's true. Uh-huh. So foreign ministries, at least in France, are still very important. They decide on foreign policy, and they rely on their policy planning staff a lot. But joke aside, I would venture that a couple of things. The first one is, there is a diplomatic, so that's to go in the sense of what Jan was saying, there is a diplomatic knowledge or know-how or sensitivity which is necessary and which should not be skipped for the escalation reason you gave, but also for the expertise itself. And so this, and to take a slightly different angle, this is also a question that will be put to Mogherini as she takes up on her job, which is what her relations will be with the Commission. I think, I mean, we're not going to do lessons learned, but I do think that we have run the risk, or we have seen the effects of what I would call under-politicization of some issues. I will give just two brief examples. The first one is Ukraine, is the DCFTA association agreement. I think the EEAS was not sufficiently involved in managing the diplomatic aspects of that. And I really do think this should have been. But there's a second one, perhaps, Marta, would be how the Environment Commissioner dealt with the issue of the emission trading system for the international aviation at the International Aviation Organization. I think she was right, and I think the EU was right in trying to get the aviation emissions, which are completely outside of any international framework of reducing emissions, they are outside of Kyoto, etc., into the mainfold. But the way it was done, I would argue, we've been waiting for other countries to act and multilaterally, and they've not, so we've acted basically unilaterally. And I think a dose of diplomatic expertise and input into this would indeed have yielded better results. And so based on these two examples, I do think that among the different balances that Mogherini must get right, there's also this thing. We don't want to give her all the tools of EU foreign policy, because I think we would run the risk of over-politicization, that is to say, if countries intrude upon trade, foreign aid, etc., too much. Mm. But of course, she should have a say in things that are about external relations, like trade, foreign aid, or these energy and climate issues, a bit more than has been the case. And so this is also to speak in favor of foreign ministries.
Well, yes. By the way, a couple of months ago, the other side of the room, we had a distinguished foreign minister here, Sikorsky. So so it just shows how important foreign ministers are for Carnegie.
It was Sikorsky who said foreign ministers are finished.
Yeah. And now look at him. And now look at him.
Just because he's
finished. No, he's not. He hasn't even started. He hasn't even started. So no. So, I mean, these are all very important issues, but I want to go back to one of the issues that really struck me was the military, the very small section on military. There's no mention of hard power in this paper, and I would like to ask whoever wants to take up this question on the panel. I mean, what is foreign policy without hard power?
Here and there. There was some quite good stuff, I thought, on hard power issue.
I think there's an entire annex on security.
Well, I haven't got the annex.
Well, it's...
You got up to page 11, so in that
This is shocking. This is shocking, Judy.
I got up to the authors. Who are the
page
authors?
12,
no, 13. Excuse me.
Improve the EU's ability...
Page 9. Do not shy away from political confrontation. The EU has no interest in accommodating a neo-imperialist power in its eastern neighbourhood that is keen on expanding control over other issues using coercive means, including military force. But... actually, what we are now facing, I mean, what foreign policy is, what foreign policy has to be underpinned is the instruments of soft power. But we have to decide, what kind of hard power instruments we're going to use as well. Do we have these?
The point is made very clear in the paper, to be honest. What I would say on that is that, in my view, economic policy in this moment and foreign policy go in opposite direction, in the sense that the kind of fiscal stringency at the national level prevents us to spend enough for defense and security policy. If we look to Italy, for instance, we just decided to cut down again the defense budget, which is a shame. And it is clear that we need to pooling and sharing, etc. It will be very difficult to build up a real capability in military terms, cutting down national budgets.
But Jan, you mentioned whoever the authors wrote this, the demilitarization of Europe has to be stopped. How?
Well, I think, I mean, that's very simple to answer. Whether it's done is another question. We have to spend the money that we have better, and we will ultimately have to spend more. I think there's no way around it. Even when we do pooling and sharing at the maximum level of what's possible in the most positive scenario on pooling and sharing, that'll not give us the return that we will need. But there's no willingness for this. Even the Ukraine crisis, I think, has not really been a major wake-up call. It has been in individual states, but it has not been an across-the-board kind of European movement in that direction. And quite to the contrary, there are allergic reactions to this, even when you insert it into the debate. To get back to your original question, what is foreign policy without hard power? I mean, we were very cautious in our paper on hard security. We put an annex on security stuff in there And even on the first page, there is a reference to it, that it needs to be stronger. But we know we have no illusions about the state of military affairs in Europe, you know, and what's possible within the next, you know, 2 or 3 or 4 years. I think that's actually very limited. And therefore, we think that even small progress is big progress in the EU. And then what we put in the annex is cybersecurity, where actually the network nature of the EU is almost like a kind of, you know, it always makes it the ideal organization to deal with that a bit more. But then again, cyber is a lot about intelligence, and that means that it's difficult. You know, in the end, I think you have to accept that foreign policy and diplomacy will be in a state of underdevelopment if it doesn't have a hard power component. Mm. Diplomacy lives off a hard security, hard power element to back it up. We are a huge player money-wise in the Middle East. We are zero player in the Middle East because we can't issue security guarantees. Mm. It's just the one currency of diplomacy. And you know, we were cautious, but if you are really, you know, honest to yourself, we will not be a diplomatic powerhouse ever if there's not a, you know, a considerable military backbone to underpin it, either in the member states or at some very, very distant future time, perhaps even in a pooled and shared kind of way.
Justin. Oh, I just wanted to make a quote. I like this quote saying that every country has an army, its own or that of another country. Just think about it. Mm.
I am thinking about that. and Sikorsky actually said that he would be much happier without any army, any foreign army in Poland, except he's happy to have NATO there.
Yeah, exactly.
Robin, correct me if I'm wrong, but next year there'll be the new British Defence Review, Strategic Review, and we have seen a practical decimation of Europe's, what used to be one of the world's great military powers, which affects Europe. Mm-hmm. This demilitarization, taking what Jan has said, I mean, how do you reverse this? 200 billion euros is not peanuts. This is what we spend every year.
Look, it's very difficult to reverse, and I think you're absolutely right to point out the UK, which, you know, along with France, one of the two European members, permanent members of the UN Security Council, proud of their military heritage and their ability to bring the military dimension to diplomacy and to international affairs. And despite that, it's one of the sectors that's taken very hard cuts. And although the government promised that if it won in the next election, that it would start increasing the spending again in the next parliament, the numbers, as we've seen right now in this rather bizarre shadow game in the UK about the UK being an austerity country, which is a little weird as a place still running 5%+ of the GDP as a deficit, never mind, but still, we're going to have that going for quite a long time into the next parliament. So actually that idea that we'd be able to cut down and build up again, although there is some modernization taking place, we're being forced to some very difficult choices in the UK in terms of the nuclear commitment, aircraft carriers, things that perhaps at one point made sense in a larger global sense, but the ability to be able to pool with others and team with others, we don't have as much money to spend as we did. What it means, though, is that so long as Europe is still in a period of economic recovery from this really devastating financial crisis, which really masked the fact that all European countries, the UK included, are having to adjust from a welfare-focused system of economic growth to one in which it is not competitive anymore to sustain it. We're having to make such difficult political choices. The spending money on defense is really difficult when so much, as you said, of power is centralized in the Chancellor of the Prime Minister's office. They can't argue it. So, I mean, I think the UK will not descend below a certain level, but the idea that we're going to be able to step up again and perhaps lead a sense of a bit of a renaissance of European military capability is just not going to happen for the near term.
Which is really ironic, given that in an economic crisis it should spur pooling and sharing and more efficiency, but it isn't. The question that
pooling and sharing doesn't always make things more efficient.
No,
this is part of the problem.
It doesn't. Well, we've seen the Airbus, we've seen the A400M. I mean, frankly,
it's part of the problem.
Made fly safely. But this brings us. This should bring us to the transatlantic relationship to NATO, because actually it is NATO that, excuse the pun, is calling the shots now in the Baltics, doing, I mean, the EU security provider, or ESDP or CFSP, is playing nothing, no role whatsoever in the Baltics, in reassuring the Allies. Of course it's NATO, but you wonder is how much longer the United States will accept this demilitarization of Europe. In terms of, you know, they want, I mean, the Americans want Europe to be a serious foreign policy
Absolutely.
Player. They want Europeans to do the burden sharing. They want Europe to get the finished business, the business finished in the Balkans.
Yeah, they said so very clearly since a very long time, I guess. The alternative is not clear, not even to the United States, because after all, they also need Europe. So it's a difficult balancing act. But looking to the future of the U.S.-European relationship, I think that TTIP is equally important.
Yep.
The Trade and Investment Partnership, this is a point I guess you make in the paper, and 2015 will be really a key here for that. I would like to underline the importance of that, because either we are able to build up this core and to renew, if you wish, the transatlantic relationship at the core of this liberal order we would like to enlarge, or it would be really much more difficult.
I just want to say that I agree with that point. Just though quickly, I think to say that NATO is looking after the Baltics and Europe isn't, I mean, as you well know, Judy, I mean, NATO is made up mostly of European countries, which are committing under the NATO Readiness Action Plan.
Guarantees.
Both commitments and are starting to put a few troops in there as tripwires, et cetera, et cetera. So to my point of view, I thought the Wales Summit actually worked pretty well in that sense, that it was quite difficult, but it has led, I think, to a shift institutionally, certainly amongst militaries and defense ministries, to start to think differently about European commitments to actually hard security in Europe, through NATO, however, not through the EU.
Actually, I'm glad you raised this issue, the Wales Summit. I mean, what was most interesting was not the Wales Summit per se, it was the debate taking place in Finland and in Sweden, and what's happening in the northern tier of Europe.
Yep.
And it's not just about Ukraine or the Baltics, it's about the Arctic Circle.
Yep.
Now, which brings us in, and Jan, this is an old hobby horse of mine. I mean, this paper is about foreign policy, but also a successful foreign policy requires a shared perception of threats.
Yeah.
Have you reached that stage in Europe yet?
No, I mean, it's quite obvious that we haven't. Neither in the EU nor in NATO. In NATO, I think political pressure is easier to channel, if you will, than in the EU, and so you can create unity even when you have diverging views. But across Europe, not. I mean, the Ukraine is a good example, but not only. You know, people in the south and look at things differently from the north and east and west. We have those divides, and we can't, you know, just poker them away. And this is why, I mean, Fabrice knows this. That is one of my hobby horses as well. That both my recommendations to the NATO SecGen and also to Ms. Mogherini would be to make themselves the advocates of a shared threat assessment. And in the sense that I also risk antagonizing some of their client member states by making a suggestion what the shared threat is. If you feed it into a working group and have all 28 and both organizations agree, what you will get is something that will be very thin.
Mm.
But if you have one of the leading people just go out there and say, this is what I suggest is our shared threat, then you get the debate because some will disagree. And again, a shared threat perception is a lot about process. And I think we need daring people suggesting what the threat is so that we can actually kind of rub ourselves against that. Whereas what we have now is a least common denominator, which means you get nothing.
And especially as the response, certainly in Eastern Europe, Central Europe, will need to be across a spectrum of security in which maybe NATO, including its European members, are playing at the hard end, the EU is playing at the softer end, and then there's some blending in the middle in police forces, gendarmerie, anti-corruption, border surveillance. Ultimately, the response is going to have to be NATO plus EU. So as Jan is saying, if you're not sharing the assessment, how are you going to end up with with the outcome?
This is also why I thought that when SecGen Rasmussen, in the last couple of months of his tenure, where he antagonized a lot of people in the member states by being very, very strong on Russia, well, you can disagree or you can agree with him, but the point is that there's somebody who's making a claim.
Yes.
And then you can actually argue with it, and thereby it becomes very much clearer. Where, and that's why I was actually thankful to him, and not so much because of the point he made, even though I happen to share his assessment, but because he actually dared saying something.
Mm.
And that's, there's a striking absence of people daring to say something in this town on these things.
Mm. It's calling for, clear leadership and clarity. You wanted to come in on on...
Well, no, just to reinforce Robin's point about the fact that many European members of NATO sent troops and fighter jets to Poland and other countries to enforce their sovereignty over their airspace, but also just for reassurance. And you know, more generally, we should not start from the premise that it would be a given that we would share threats, because we don't share the same threats. I mean, when you're Portugal or Ireland, you don't share the same threats as when you're Lithuania, right? And when you're Spain, when you're Italy, in terms of migration, or when you're France or Germany or the UK in terms of foreign fighters, you don't share the same threats. Or when you have a very active trade relations with Asia, you're not exposed to the same extent to piracy off the coast of Somalia or to other disruptions. And so it takes efforts to agree on a common definition of the threats, and it takes solidarity. I think it's not like a geopolitical or intellectual disagreement. It's just reality where we don't exactly share the same threats, but how do we bridge that, and how does your vulnerability becomes mine, so we can work jointly?
But that is something that is not being said in this town, that we don't share threats, you know?
Exactly.
Everybody has this kind of lukewarm agreement that we share some threats, yes, somehow, but neither does that mean anything on the yes, we do share them, nor does it mean a lot on the no, we don't share. But this is a great statement. I like this. This is good. No, we don't share. Now let's work around this, make solidarity the key argument. I think that's a constructive way of going about it, instead of this kind of, you know, eerie silence.
Well, Den Yang, I'll have to pick you up on this. Before we open this discussion out onto the floor, I've got one quick but very important question, which is a central element of this paper, the role of China. I mean, sitting around here, do we see China as a competitor, a threat, an opportunity? Are we ready to? It's not clear. I'd like to see how you see China.
You know, I'm happy to take a first stab at it. I guess it's all of these things at the same time, and that's why we need diplomats, right? I mean, because it's just to manage complexity. Mm. If we could summarize the complexity of foreign policy to the cherished simplicity of one bumper sticker slogan, Ostpolitik or containment, etc., it would be nice, but we can't. It's just reality. We can't. We have too many interests. Yeah. Interwoven interest, and China in particular has too many has too much importance in too many issues for us to reduce it to just one one catchphrase. And so what I think we should always sort of keep sight of is that the world that Europe has created, once again this issue of norms and narrative, and that the US and Europe in particular, but others as well, have created over all these decades since 1945, is a world in which we feel comfortable, in which we are able to prosper, etc. And China has been able to prosper in that very world. But it doesn't, and that's really important, it doesn't feel comfortable in that world. I think on many different issues, China thinks that that world, that order, is Western, and that it won't do justice to its growth, to its legitimate claims, etc. And so it is both taking advantage of this world, and that's good, and being a stakeholder on some issues, and challenging it and contesting it in some others. And so I'm not saying we should resist that by all means. I'm just saying that we should be clear about what the norms, what the rules of the road for the future are, so that the world remains rather comfortable for Europe.
But complex too.
I think there are two important points on China, moreover. The first one is that China is entering Europe with important investments in its infrastructures, energy, et cetera, et cetera. So this is not only a problem of what do we do as Europe in East Asia, which is the traditional way of looking at, but we have China here in Europe. And the second point is Africa, because Africa is a bit overlooked in the paper, if I may say so. But China and Africa is a real problem. Our relationship with the US will be important if we look to Africa together. And there is an important point concerning energy diversification. For instance, one of the lessons Eni drew from the crisis with Russia is to try to reconvert to new sources of oil and gas, playing a sort of north-south card instead of a east-west one. And this is in agreement with the US, so this is changing completely the geopolitics of energy.
It's very important you mentioned. Quick,
just one very quick point about China, because again, I think it's one of the good things about this paper is the extent to which it really brings this issue up, puts Europe in its true global context. It does through many of the aspects. It does point quite a bit to the China risks. What if it collapses, territorial disputes? I think one of the things we need to think about is what if China succeeds as well? Because if it carries on and they manage themselves, I mean, the weight of China is massive. Yes. And interestingly, and I think it gets a bit to Justin's points, China has interest in a rules-based order. Mm-hmm. And ultimately, China may play more on the rules agenda with Europe than America might.
Very interesting. Now, I want to open up this to the audience. Wait a second. I'm taking bunches of three questions. One, identify yourselves. Two, short and to the point question. I'm not going to encourage statements. Guinevere first, every second, this lady is second, and this gentleman there is third. I go back, this gentleman there is third. I have to do it. Guinevere first, please identify yourself. Now.
Genek Smola, Warsaw, foreign policy analyst. It's a good preparation for the meeting with the European policy planners, which I'm going to have in half an hour. I would concentrate and would like to ask you, before we go and to have an apparent policy toward China, which we don't, we have a trade policy. We don't have a policy toward China. It reminds me of a song, Jacques Dutron sang 700 millions de Chinois, et moi, et moi, et moi. The ambassador, EU ambassador to China have told me that his big success was to force DGs to inform him about the delegations coming to China, not to mention what to do about. The question is, is not less the better in our new approach to the foreign policy? We should stop civil war of the institutions. I hope that this commission will be better streamlined than the previous one. But actually, the competition between different parts of the commission and the ES prevented it from doing a job. Full stop. So any ideas on that?
Great question.
Coordination. Yeah. And second, if I may, is something which was mentioned.
No, if you start, everybody else will have a chance.
You know me.
No, I'm sorry. Please. I'm sorry, Ginnick. They'll answer your question, though. Yes, please.
Thank you. Rosa Balfour from the European Policy Centre. I think I need to give you a paper that I've just written precisely on this, arguing that doing less is not better on foreign policy. No, what I wanted to say, the first thing about Eastern Partnership, Justin, you said it was the antechamber to accession. I think a lot of countries felt that it fell short of being the antechamber of accession. And actually, the EU has been carrying this ambiguity for a whole decade between the Orange Revolution and last year. And I think that ambiguity has harmed EU policy as well as the countries. I know you, I'm going to be brief. So, and I think that ambiguity is actually one source of fragmentation because it underlines the different perceptions, number one. Number two, if the Arab Spring and Crimea have not jolted the EU into becoming more conscious of the need to be a global actor, what will? That's for everyone.
Thanks, Rosa. And the third, the Dutch, I think you're an old Dutch journalist colleague. I forgot, Roy.
Well, formerly a journalist.
Yeah, but you know.
My name is Robert van der Roer. I'm a diplomatic commentator, trainer of CEOs, and formerly a journalist.
It's not your fault being a former journalist. Okay. Only joking.
Thank you for your great insights, but let's humanize for a moment. Mogherini is widely perceived as a diplomatic rookie. Perhaps that's the reason why she was chosen. I would like to hear the view of the panel. How big of a problem is her lack of experience?
Okay, thank you. Three great questions. Ginnick, we'll take Ginnick's question first. Less better, stop the competition, the institutions, and Jan, I can't ask Stefan. Because he's not on the panel, unfortunately. I'll likely
we can well ask him.
He can ask him. We can ask him if he wants to. But we should kick off with Jan's question, then we go on to Noah's question about if we haven't learned anything from the from the Arab Spring and Crimea, and the third one is Mogherini, lack of experience. Anyway, so Jan, will you
quick
pick
one
up this?
I think Genick actually had two questions: is less better,
I
and how to stop the civil war.
Those
were two. So Genick, you're safe. Is less better? No. Only if you can really clearly prioritize, which is one of the big problems of this town, because not prioritizing is the way to create consensus. And if you want to do less and focus on two or three or four things, then you will have a super, super bitter discussion about what these two or three or four things should be. That might be healthy, but in absence of this, I'm afraid that we probably should have to focus on the whole kind of bandwidth of issues. And Rosa, what will jolt the EU into becoming a bigger player? I really don't know, but I think it comes back to the question that one of the answers that I gave earlier. I think the real pain of this has not been felt. This has not been existential yet, neither economically nor security-wise for us. And if you are a cynic, you can say, well, learning through pain is the only method. And also the Americans haven't really abandoned Europe yet. And so the pressure is low still.
That's
for Europeans, if we're honest. We are kind of artificially talking the pressure up because we think it's super important. But, the bulk of people don't think it's particularly high. Finally, Mogherini's lack of experience. I listened to her during the hearings. I found her, for the inner logic of this bubble that we're in, I found her very, very convincing. She was strong. Enormous communication skills, great way to deal with the people, exactly the messages that people here wanted to hear, parliament and so on. And I had a meeting with her yesterday, actually, and it was fantastic, really, great. Is the weight there to bring to the negotiating table the battle weight that you need, the resilience and the super toughness, is something that we haven't seen yet. So it's hard to say, but I think we should get away from this talk, how weak she is, how inexperienced she is and all this, and get into this kind of, give this lady a chance. She's clearly ambitious. She wants something. She's demonstrated this. Now let her do it.
Anybody want to come into any of the three questions, or should we move along?
Federica, yeah.
If I may restate,
underline this point, because first of all, foreign policy is her field since the very beginning. She is 40-something, and she has been working in foreign policy for 20 years now. And then she has been working for the Foreign Affairs Department of the Democratic Party of the Left in Italy, which is, in any case, a school for foreign policy, even if with a certain bias, clearly. But no, I agree. I think with Jan that she in theory, she can be good in theory, provided that what she has to do is doable. And from this point of view, I think that the real point is whether she will be able to implement this new cluster system to be the chief of the RELEX. If she succeeds on that, we will have a bit better.
Thanks,
foreign
Martin.
Policy.
That's very nice.
I was just going to pick up, one question hasn't been picked up, so let me just, on the neighborhood policy, just say, from my impression, I'm not a student of neighborhood policy, but I think it's not the ambiguity about enlargement, because you have to be ambiguous in a way about enlargement, because there's no political support other than to be ambiguous, but it's not being sufficiently political about the process of its value. And this was visible in Ukraine. We could talk more about it, but I think it's the lack of political sense behind it. Too technical, not politically enough.
Absolutely.
But on what will push the EU into being awake, where I'm sitting from, I'm quite impressed. I think the response to Russia has been very impressive to Ukraine. 28 countries agreeing on sanctions that carry real cost in the middle of a recession when a lot of people don't feel the pain and don't feel it's existential. I think a lot of politicians have gone out on a limb. I put Angela Merkel at the top of them. And I think it's impressive, actually. So I think we're actually doing okay.
Yeah, I'm not meant to say agree or disagree.
You agree?
But I agree. Now, we've got three. The gentleman there with your hand up and the gentleman there with the glasses, and you're the third. Please. Identify yourself in a short question.
Yeah, Alan Bowman. I'm with the Canadian mission to the EU here, but I just left the Canadian Foreign Ministry's policy planning staff, so I endorse everything Justin Vaïsse says about the importance of the role of these offices within foreign ministries.
No stopping them.
I promised that I would stop saying the word narrative when I left the policy planning staff, but I'll make an exception today. But Justin spoke quite a bit about the Western narrative being in danger in the emerging world. the fact that we're losing the fight on norms, on human rights, on trade, on all kinds of issues. But there were few solutions to, there were few ideas as to what we do about it. And the Americans are proposing TPP and TTIP as an effort to sustain those norms. Will there be any original ideas coming out of the new commission on that particular front? Thank you.
Thank you very much. You please. Yes.
Thank you. Giovanni Grevi with Fride. First question. It was said that we are in a world...
One question.
First of one and a half. no, very quick. We are in a world of different poles and powers, not necessarily in a world of blocks. Are we moving towards a world of blocks, in your view? And in this context, in particular, how do you read developments and trends on Chinese-Russian relations? And what does it imply for Europe?
Thank you.
Second, piggybacking on this one very quickly, what is the selling point of Europe in this diverse world? It is a question that goes back to the question of narrative, but in particular in terms of Europe's selling point, if any. Thank you.
That was a great question, Giovanni. Thank you. And the gentleman beside you. Hello.
Thank you, Judy. Joe Kuhlman from the Egmont Institute and for the Royal Higher Institute for Defense. So indeed, military. And so my question will be to no surprise. It's about indeed the military. I can read in your annex that there's this element, invest in European capabilities. That is correct. But if you want to invest, the first question that you encounter is to do what? Now, if we look a little bit further on, it's mentioned that security sector reform should be the trademark for European Union. That is fine. But it is also mentioned that this include police, judicial, and military, and in that order. So that's also fine. And the only task that I see further on is cyber. Cyber is important. But then again, the military is not to be the primus inter pares. So if the question is, I have to invest as a military, and looking to this annex, I only have to hire additional people for the cyber. So my question is operations of crisis management, autonomous operations of crisis management for the European Union, a task or not? And I think that that is rather important if we want to save our transatlantic relationship and if we want to save NATO. Thank you.
Great, great crop of questions. Thank you. Jan, can I leave you with the crisis management question?
Yes, I the answer to the question is yes. I think autonomous operations should be the goal. I know that the NATO-only school will not like that message, but I think I think this is important because not only does it make us less dependent on the United States services, it will also make us more interesting for the United States as an ally. So it cuts both ways. There's no, you know, becoming more independent from the US, you know, because then we can do what they don't like. It's actually because it makes us more interesting as an ally. And that's what we need to invest into. I think it's very clear what we want to do with these investments. We need these. We have seen interventions in the last few years in our immediate neighborhood. We need to be better at those. And we need to be able to do, you know, crisis management, perhaps even longer distance. And we need to do security sector reform, which requires forces. And we perhaps even need to have the occasional little deterrent force here or there. But even though I will leave that mostly to NATO. So I think when you actually look to the essay, I think when you just look at the second page, I think, not just at the annex, I think we're talking about that autonomous capability, which we think is really important.
Thanks, Jan, for this. Robin, you wanted to deal with...
Yes, maybe just something on blocks very quickly and Europe's selling point as that was put together. But on blocks, again, maybe we should be short about this because my instinct is no. I just don't think we're going to a world of blocks. I think these are axes of convenience, to use the phrase that's been used before, whether it's BRICS, China, Russia, you know, North America. I mean, I don't think we're going to a world of blocks. Don't see it. So let's just stop on that point. Let me say something about Europe's selling point, because this is a very interesting question. And having returned a number of years ago now from the US and moved back to Europe, I think it's the only part of the world that has discovered a way so far, and is fighting to sustain it, and I hope it does, of delivering socially just or socially minded prosperity. You know, this is a really, really difficult thing to do. And we were able to do it partly because we in Europe were ahead of the curve. And we had industrialization before many others, and then the the deals that had to be done after the Second World War so that we wouldn't have the kind of extremist politics that emerged in the interwar years meant that we then came up with a different system. American way as a winner was able to be more capitalistic and still entrepreneurial about its social system, whereas I think in Europe, governments had to strike mm-hmm. deals with their publics. Now we're struggling to sustain them, but we've got it now. Even if we had to cut back and be more selective and so on, it is an amazing example for other parts of the world that mm-hmm. they come and look at and try to see. So to fight for it and to sustain it, yeah. I think, is one of the most powerful things that we can mm-hmm. do. Also, I believe that Europeans have very positive views of the value stuff that Judy mentioned earlier, of what human dignity, individual rights, democracy, all of the positive things that can bring about life. But in a way, because we're not so powerful, we can't impose it. And because we can't impose it, we don't try to impose it. And actually, that ends up being a strength. So people look at what Europe's achieved. Mm-hmm. They look at least what it aspires to. They're a bit worried as to whether we're going to survive our existential crisis right now of demography and structural problems. But if we can, that's mm-hmm. pretty powerful. And I think in today's world, where it's very hard to make change happen from instigation, mm-hmm. it becomes a powerful narrative. So I'm quite optimistic on Europe.
It's very thoughtful, Robin, especially in the light of what happened at the Romanian elections.
Yeah.
Really interesting. Justin, you want to... Can I pass on to the next? Actually, to be fair, we did our crisis management, dealt with the crisis management, invest what we do, the new commission. That would take a long time. Nobody knows. But, I mean, Juncker hasn't really come up with anything yet. Giovanni, who asked the question?
Exactly. Think.
Another group of three. Jessica? Yes. Jessica, please put up the other hands. I didn't see. One at the back, way over here. You were fourth. One at the back, and you were somebody over here too? Jessica's first. Please go ahead.
Okay, thanks. Just listening to this conversation as an American and reading the paper as an American, it strikes me that one thing that is perhaps not as prominent here as I think it should be is that the United States badly needs Europe as a strategic ally and as a strategic actor. And, you know, we went through this period of, I call it semi-madness in the unipolar moment. U.S. going to rule the world. You know, the bookstore is full of books that had the word empire in the title. Thank heaven we're gone from that. And the reaction to that was the lead from behind, pull back. There are maybe issues where we don't need to be the team captain. We can just be a player or even on the bench. This could be a perhaps more sustainable world than sustainable world for the United States after 70 years of really being the central pillar of the world order. But And the pullback approach certainly hasn't succeeded. Either the world isn't ready for it, or maybe never will be, I don't know. But this leaves the United States, I think, in limbo in thinking about its role in the world. It is very gray. Nobody quite knows, and it's more than just the fatigue of two unsuccessful wars. To me, one answer to it is that the U.S. needs to share this role with somebody, and the somebody is the EU mm-hmm. or Europe. Mm-hmm. Europe individually, because where else in the world is it?
Yeah.
I heard maybe in Robin's early comment, I agree that no foreign policy can be stronger than a country is at home or a group of countries. I agree with that. But I thought I heard perhaps an argument that the original European ambition to create this extraordinary collection of countries with a very high standard at home still is preeminent, and then I thought to myself, but that will never be over, right? So that means, is Europe ever going to be ready to be a strategic actor? So I'm trying to provoke maybe a more open confrontation of this question.
Thank you very much for this. We're running out of time. We've got our three authors here. Do you, we have a chance to? This is your chance if you want to. If you want to come in on any of the points, now is your chance. Stefan says. Stefan Nalen says no. Daniel says no. They all got very shy. Uli. Okay. Then we'll take two more questions, and I would like Jessica's to be dealt with. Gentleman at the back, please. Yes, you.
Yes, David van Dusen, University of Leuven. On page 9, I read, this has already been quoted, the EU has no interest in accommodating a neo-imperialist power in its eastern neighborhood. And I'm curious if anyone can honestly deny that this describes Turkey very well. It seems to me that the paper takes a very 20th century approach to Turkey, rather than a 21st.
Thank you. Carly Banya, I think.
Thank you, Carly Banya, former Hungarian PSC ambassador, currently a PhD candidate. Bearing in mind the way how the Russians use energy to penetrate into Central Eastern Europe, my question is there any chance for a unified EU common energy strategy, or at least the expression of solidarity, bearing in mind the diverging or different national interests in this field,
Thank you very much. We have Jessica's raised a very, very important issue about, you know, even if the Europeans in fact understand the malaise that America is going through. Jan, do you want to dwell on this issue? Which is so complex.
Well, yes, I would love to leave this to Justin, because he's the man to answer it. I can only say yes. I think if there are two kind of, you know, repositories, you know, of populations at large that feel responsible for more than just themselves in the world, it is actually North America and Europe in the end. I mean, without, you know, trying to talk this down, I was just at a conference in Brazil, at a security conference, biggest security conference in Latin America, interesting debates, but not at all a sense of, you know, very, very consumerist response, very, you know, what can they do for us instead of what can we do for them? I'm generalizing. Okay. But if you're looking for this two strong repositories for global stability, it needs to be us in the United States. I'm very old school on this, and if we make ourselves weak and don't do anything to become stronger, then the world is in trouble, not just us.
Thanks, Jan.
Just to finish on what Jan was saying, I would have two sort of provisos. The first one is that is true, but we shouldn't take this point too far, because the retort or the reply would be, haha, you are thinking that you are being you know, generous and universalist and thinking of the others while you are only catering to your own interest, and you use international law, you bend it when it suits you, and then you blame us for bending it, etc. So I am with you on that, but we should be really careful about how it plays elsewhere. The second thing is, because of what you said, I slightly disagree with one point in the paper about you know, leaving more space to emerging countries in multilateral institutions. No. Of course, at some point we need to do that, but we shouldn't do that under any circumstances or hastily, I would say. We should think really hard on how we do it, how we devolve them more power, because we should, because not all of them, and I once again, it's just what you said, not all of them are as much guardians of the interest that multilateralism represents as we have been. And so self-effacement should not sort of be too hasty for fear of endangering, once again, that world of norms that we share it. And on Jessica's point, you know, I guess we've seen tides of American, you know, introversion and extroversion, right? There was retrenchment and pullback in the 50s, in the 70s, perhaps in the 90s it's debatable, but certainly in the 2010s. But we've not left that world where the US is dominant. For me, in spite of everything I said about the new balance of power, etc., it's still a world where the US leads, and it gets to the point that Jan was making earlier, that is to say, one reason why Europe has not developed more defense is that because it was provided by by the U.S. And so the U.S. was both asking us to get off the dope and give us and giving us dope. I'm not saying that the U.S. is to blame for that. I'm just saying that the conditions that were created induced a sort of anesthesia in terms of defense. And so will Europe ever be a strategic actor, you asked? From my perspective, but once again, I'm repeating what Jan said, it will become when the absence or when the cut or when the pullback from the U.S. will be more dramatic and will force Europe to be one. Unfortunately, I've become very pessimistic about Europe being able to sort of create create more of an autonomous hard power instrument absent a very strong external incentive to do so. And the U.S. pulling back could be one. More threat, more existential threat from the East could be another one. Barring that, I think we'll still be in sort of an in-between situation.
Robin, you wanted to come in quickly?
Yeah, on the U.S. thing as well, Jessica's point. I mean, I agree with her analysis, the flow. I mean, you're commenting about the bench. You know, the problem of trying to come back from the bench is hard for somebody on the bench to become captain again. You know, if I'm taking the metaphor that way, once people look that you're in two minds and you take this one and now I want to step back up as leader, just psychologically, people get used to a different flow of power and relationship and others can fit in. So I think we are in a more complicated space. We as Europeans are not going to pivot or rebalance to Asia in the same way that America is being pulled to do. And I think that is a bit of a strategic disconnect on a key strategic priority for the United States. I think that Europe, I'm afraid to fit your final point, is self-focused at the moment, inevitably so. But I think Europeans look at America and say, well, America's pretty self-focused as well. And they look at the way the Congress has stymied, to a certain extent, Obama's capacity for action. But also most Europeans have been pretty disappointed that President Obama's multilateral instincts don't seem to have translated into an internationalism that we can connect with as much across the board as Europeans thought they were going to connect, yes? But he's ended up being more of a domestic president than most Europeans perhaps expected. There is a sense of associating, let's get outside this room, but in many electorates, including amongst some of the far right or far left on extremes, but going into the middle, there's a sense of associating America with the bad side of globalization. And whether it's NSA-ness, whether it's the negative side of TTIP, investor-state dispute settlement mechanisms, a lot of the anti-TTIPness, to the question was asked earlier, you know, is emerging from this, that it's kind of American rules that are going to undercut the precautionary, more social approach that Europeans have used to protect their citizens and to develop their system of government. So actually, the one issue that really we do need to succeed on, and I agree with others, which is TTIP, at least for going forward, is at the moment becoming a thorn in the relationship rather than an opportunity. Yes. And I think ultimately we need to make TTIP succeed, and we as Europeans mustn't fail on our support on Ukraine and our role in Russia. Otherwise, you know, if we can't work on our neighborhood and America's having to work on Asia, we've got a big problem.
Yes, of course. Follow up on that very briefly. Really, I think that TTIP is very important for geopolitical reasons more than for economic reasons. And here on TTIP, the role of Germany becomes very important. We didn't talk at all about specific countries that after all make most of European foreign policy. I would say that Germany really is the key country to look at. I consider that the way in which Germany is reshaping its foreign policy is promising from a certain point of view, but certainly we have a problem between Germany and the US, and this will be crucial. Lastly, I have a point that is, if you wish, a bit different one, but we do not have to see at the European Union as a static actor, in my view. In a couple of years, we could have a totally different situation, for instance, if the UK decides to leave the European Union. That will make a huge difference for foreign policy and defense. So, I mean, the European Union can evolve in different ways. It's important to keep the eye open on that. And especially, I think that the way in which we could more efficiently deal with neighborhood is to go back to the old idea of concentric circles, but I think this would be really important.
Yes, thank you. I'm glad you brought up that issue. Thank you, Martin. We had a question on Turkey, and I haven't forgotten the Russian energy issue. The question on Turkey was are we looking at Turkey in a rather 20th century through 20th century lens? And what do you mean?
What do I mean? Mm-hmm.
Just very briefly, I want to make sure I understand your question.
The question was honestly inspired by the fact that last night I was at a policy conference at the European Parliament and with Yazidis and Assyrian Christians and Kurds. And there's absolute unanimity that the most inimical actor, state actor in the region, worse than Saudi Arabia and Qatar, is Turkey.
Okay.
And the facts on the ground all confirm this. But it seems to me that, so this is slightly off topic, but I mean, it seems to me that quite well known that there's a kind of expansionist ideology which has come in with Erdogan.
Okay.
So which is making itself felt in Syria and elsewhere. And there was nothing said critically of Turkey.
So essentially, the paper didn't pay attention specifically to the Turkish issue.
Well, they took a very, very strong position apropos of Russia and none.
General sentence, I guess, on Turkey, because we have huge discussions in Carnegie on Turkey with Mark Pirini and Sinan Ilgin being our scholars in this field. I think Turkey, it's not entirely clear to most of us yet that this is one of the big strategic challenges of the future for the reasons that you have named, but also even if it became more of the old Turkey again, that was more, you know, West friendly, it would still be a huge and humongous strategic task for us to take on. That's number one. And then the second thing is that Mark Pirini says that we are running the risk of having a deeply ideologically antagonistic player on our southeastern flank, deeply ideologically antagonistic to the West, a big growing country, strong country, and we haven't found an instrument yet to counter that. I mean, that's all I can say. That's very general. But if you want to have a deeper discussion on this, you know, contact us and we'll get you connected to the right people.
Thank you for the question and answering it, answering your own question. Thanks, Jan. Energy, Carly, as always, Russian energy. So, it's an interesting debate. It's an interesting question. I mean, we'll see how far, this is a big issue, the energy security, what's going to happen if there be an energy union, are we diversifying enough?
In theory, we would like to have a energy union. So we are very ambitious. We need to comply with all the provisions of the internal market. The internal market is fragmented. Energy costs are becoming a comparative disadvantage. It's very clear. We have our industry migrating to the US because the energy costs are too high. I would say two things are really important: security, diversification, and the completion of the internal market. And from this point of view, one request we could address to Jessica is try to push for having energy within TTIP, because otherwise there is no point for us. I mean, we have to have an agreement in which we recognize some specific advantages.
Nobody wants to. We have room just for, because a lot of people have to rush off at 4:15, so room for two more questions, two short questions, please, if anybody wants to. And no, that's great. Last word from our guest. Jan, do you want to give a last word? You're not even charging for this paper.
No, but we've created strategy fatigue in this room.
Exactly.
And that's exactly what we didn't want to create. I hope that this is really the starting point. I would just say one final thing. A huge thanks to my co-authors. I'm here, the only one who has actually been an author on the, but there's of course Stefan and Daniel and Uli who are here, it was a memorable experience. Thanks a lot for your great input, and to everybody who joined us, some of you who came to our expert sessions are here in the room, and that was a great exercise. Thanks for helping us, you know, making this possible.
And Jessica, thank you very much for coming over for this. It's great to get this very, very special American view, because we really need to be reminded so often of this, and maybe there are not enough Americans at these, and our Canadian is here. Thank you very, very much. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you very much, Jan. Thank you, Justin. Your job is safe. Yes. Thank you, Robin. Chatham House, we'll work on the sponsors. Marta, very nice to see you again. Thank you very much, all of you. Thank you.